My name is Mike Reed. I'm a physiologist, a professor of physiology here at the University of Kentucky, and I work in the area of muscle biology. Our laboratory is interested in the mechanisms that cause muscle weakness. We have experiments going on right now that we've been working on for 2 years. If you cut our funding right now and we can't pursue that, then all the work that's gone into it stops. In many cases, some things that we've been doing will die. It simply can't be sustained because we're looking at live cell lines or we're looking at particular types of very thoughtfully constructed disease models. And when you stop them, you stop them. And then you have to go back and reconstruct them or reinstitute them all over again. It could impose delays of years, even if we kept our people. Right now I have 3 PhD students. Each of these students has a different project going. Each project is supported by federal funding. In some cases, these students are supported by federal training grants, which provides them with a stipend, a means to live and do their work. If we have an abrupt cessation in federal funding, not only does the research stop, but in some cases their livelihood stops. If the research stops in a research-intensive field like physiology, that means their ability to progress toward a PhD is immediately halted. They have no way to move forward without the support they need to do their work. So from the standpoint of training the next generation of highly skilled professors, industrial scientists, people to work in the pharmacy industry, people to work in government laboratories, people to advance our understanding of disease and advance the next generation of therapies, it will be profoundly devastating for this generation of students. We're deeply concerned about that.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Weaver-Smith. I'm a professor of mechanical engineering at the University of Kentucky. My area of expertise is dynamics. It's really motion. And it started with research in using vibrations to detect damage. From there, my motion research moved into deployable wing unmanned aircraft. And these really have lots of applications as well. It could be extraterrestrial exploration, like Mars airplanes, or it could be defense missions, or it could be something for the Department of Justice, or it could be something for natural disasters and helping with first responders in those situations. As the director of NASA's higher education programs for the state of Kentucky, I know that we impact about 80 students a year. And these are undergraduate scholarships and internships. These are graduate fellowships. And it's support of really important experiential education in student team projects. Annually, we impact or affect about 80 students a year in the state of Kentucky with what looks like it might be 40% program cuts. That's 30 students that are not going to have those opportunities. And of those, 12 of them are not going to have direct support. And so these students hopefully won't choose to leave STEM fields or not to pursue education, but you know, that's really the risk. It's so important for Kentucky and it's so important for the nation that these STEM students, you know, stay engaged, and that would be a great loss.
So I'm John Anthony, and I am the John C. Hubbard Professor of Chemistry. I'm affiliated with the Department of Chemistry at UK, as well as the Center for Applied Energy Research at the University of Kentucky. We make new materials for commercializing flexible flat panel displays for cell phones and tablet computers. We work on new solar energy materials for generating solar electricity at much lower cost. We've got projects in bioimaging for tumor detection. We've got projects for mitigating improvised explosive devices. We're funded by the National Science Foundation and the Office of Naval Research. Those are probably the two biggest groups from the U.S. putting money into our research programs. You know, the majority of the money that comes in from these federal agencies is supporting graduate students, undergraduate researchers, and postdoctoral scholars. And you know, these guys get a salary, they rent local homes, they pay taxes, they buy groceries, and we are essentially laying them off. So it's going to have not only an impact on the progress of our research programs to bring lower cost energy to the planet, but it's going to have a big impact on the local economy. With reduced funding, I'm going to be bringing in fewer graduate students, fewer postdocs, which means countries that are not reducing their research funding in Europe and in Asia, they're the ones that are going to be producing the next generation of innovators. We're really cutting back on the number of new scientists we're going to be pumping into the system. And these startup companies, and there are a lot of startup companies spinning up right now, they're hungry for scientists. I mean, we never have a problem with our people finding jobs. And we're really cutting funding to one of the big sources of highly trained technical workers for workforces that do produce very high-paying jobs.